And I have rehearsed and tried to pronounce this title several times last night and this morning, but it didn't succeed, but we try anyway. Welcome to this PhD, Defense in Space Rotating Programming, Mission Equipped Robots, Crew, Robotic Skills, and Robotic Mapping. I'm sure Rasmus will take us through it in a moment. First of all, my name is Ken Nielsen. I'm moderator of this PhD defense. So I'm appointed by the dean and the PhD school. And first of all, let's say welcome to Rasmus. Welcome. Secondly, we have the assessment committee up here. And first of all, welcome to Professor Associate Professor. Yeah. Markus from Vienna University of Technology. He is head of vision for robotics. That's his title. And secondly, welcome to Professor Henrik G. Petersen from Southern University of Denmark. And he is professor in industrial robotics. Finally, welcome to the chairman of the assessment committee. That's from Aalborg University, Associate Professor of Robotics. Welcome to the assessment committee. As a moderator, I have only a few practical points I'm obliged to rule as a moderator. First of all, the time, and secondly, the order in the room. So to make my job easier, should be agreed upon, you are taking it easy, sit back in the chair, and listen carefully what's going on up here, and I'm sure it's by the rules. There will be approximately 45 minutes presentation from Rasmus. After that, we have a short break, followed by a question and answer session, which will go on until the assessment committee has fulfilled their job and are satisfied with the answers. So, and you, of course, are all very welcome to follow that point. Actually, you are also allowed to come with questions, as we call it, auditorium. And if you would like to have a question, then please, in the break, inform me, and then I'll call you when you're ready for that question. After the Q&A, the assessment committee will do the final assessment. It will take approximately 30 minutes while they're doing the assessment. Reception, if you go on in the common room, and you can get by 14. All are welcome, and the assembly is so you are very welcome to follow the reception. Yes, I think that was the practical part of it. So I'll leave the word to you, Rasmus.
Okay, thank you very much. So, yes, my name is Rasmus. So, I love you, so those of you who might not know that. And I've been doing this PhD project, and I can also give it a try with the title. So we call it Facilitating Programming of Vision-Equipped Robots through Robotic Skills and Projection Mapping. So that's quite a lot, and let's start off with an agenda of what I'm going to present to you today. So I'll start off with some introduction first to general, what is a PhD study, and how was it for me, and then motivation for the project that I did. Then we have two parts. I have two parts of this PhD project. The first related to vision in a user-oriented skill framework, and the second to projection-mapping task-based, projection-based task-based interfaces. And the main way that this presentation will be in the second part, which is in the newest contributions that I've made, basically simply because of the time restriction, so we have to focus on some of that. But I'll go through both parts. So first, a little bit about the PhD study. So maybe some of you have seen this series. It's called Big Bang Theory. And for those of you who have seen that, you all know what a PhD is and how the life of a PhD student is. For the rest of us, we can look a little bit on the formal requirements. So in a PhD, you have to make a PhD project and a thesis. Then you have to take PhD courses of approximately 30 years. So the university world is a little bit special. Here we don't measure time in days, weeks, and months like the rest of the world. We measure ETTS instead, and those ETTS is more or less half a year out of the 3 years that it takes to do a PhD project here in Denmark. Then you have to do dissemination of knowledge, that's what I'm doing here today, and then you have to participate in active scientific research environments, including state and foreign research institutions and companies. And I have during this PhD been part of two research groups here at Aalborg University, actually. The first one, Robotic and Automation Group, under the leadership of my main supervisor, Professor Madsen. And the second one, the Visual Analysis of People Laboratory, or short, the BAP group, under the leadership of my secondary supervisor, Thomas Mosman. Then I have had a stay at Georgia Tech in the laboratory of Henrik I. Christensen in Georgia Tech. States. And then I have been for some weeks at the private R&D company CNC in Austria. So that was a little bit introduction. So let's go to the project itself that I've been doing here. So traditional robots. Automating using traditional robots can look like some of these images. What characterizes traditional industrial robots is that they're very fast, they're very precise, they're very reliable. And that's very nice if you want to produce a lot of more or less identical items, or at least with few changes in between. Then they're very good. They can continue doing the same thing over and over and over again many times, so they will continue to produce the same result. However, they are not very flexible and difficult to set up and time-consuming also. That means that if you want to make them produce something else, then it will both take a lot of time and a lot of sometimes very specialized people. So it would be expensive to set up production lines like this to produce anything else. And in the future, especially for small and mid-sized enterprises, it will be necessary to have some more flexibility. That's not only me who is saying this, it's a citation from the EU Robotics Organization for civilian robotics funded by the European Union. And let me just read what it says. It says, in particular, manufacturing in SMEs can be automated to drive down costs. This type of low, mid to low volume, high value added manufacturing requires low installation and running costs and a high degree of flexibility, which cannot typically be provided by large scale manufacturing robotics. So robots like we saw in the previous image. And to illustrate this, we sometimes use a figure like this. So it's a very simplified figure, but it represents the principle that we have. So on this axis, we have the degree of flexibility in production, and on this axis, the degree of efficiency. So the robotics automation that we saw on the other images is out here. It's fully automated. No humans are allowed nearby the robots. And it's very efficient, not very flexible. It can only produce one thing or sometimes different things, but very similar things. Up here we have the other end of the scale with manual labor. With manual labor, it takes a long time to produce anything, but then you have a wide variety of things. If you want to produce a chair, you can make it look more or less however you want to make it look. In the future, we want to have production which is both efficient and flexible. So out here, we can look at it in different ways. That's what I try to indicate with these arrows. So we can, for instance, look at it that we want to make the robots that we have and the automation equipment more flexible, so make it faster to program, faster to set up to serve new tasks. We can also look at it in the other way, so we want to take the manual labor we have out here and make them, the people, more efficient. And we do this by giving them better tools. And some of these tools can be robots. You can actually consider a robot as a tool which makes a human more efficient. So it's two ways to look at the same problem. You might say. And if we go back to the EU robotics in their strategic research agenda, they have listed a set of robot abilities which should be used to measure progress in robotics in general. And in this PhD, I've been working with the highlighted areas here, so configurability, interaction ability, manipulation ability, and perception ability. Okay, so when we want to make robots more flexible, one of the essential things about this is the level of autonomy of a robot. And this is a taxonomy of this. So here, up here, we have a very stupid robot, which is completely remote control. The computer does not do anything, human does it all. And here we have the other end of the scale. Computer decides everything and acts autonomously. So many researchers in robotics are working in this area here. We want to make the robots more smart, able to take more decisions of their own, figure out how to solve the tasks on their own. That's not where I've been working. I've been working more in this upper area here, where we have a way of saying it, that we want to keep humans in the loop. So maybe in 100 years, or a long time from now, we will be able to have robots which are much more smart than us. So they will be able to do everything, decide everything, maybe. But it will take a very long time. So for now, it would be a good idea for many tasks to actually take advantage of the knowledge of this guy here. And instead of trying to make the robot decide everything on its own, then make it easy for a human to interact with the robot and help it do the right things, take the right decisions. And yeah, that's what I've been working with. And that's not only me who has been working with this. Actually, there is a whole field called collaborative robotics, which has spawned within the last 7-8 years, something like that. And these are all commercial robots which you can go out and buy. And what's special about these robots is that they are able to sense forces. So if they are running and you get close to them and maybe they accidentally hit you, then maybe it will hurt, probably it will hurt. But you'll not die. They'll stop before you die. Because they can sense that they're hit with you. So that's nice, and that's why even the chancellor on Lincoln is standing close to the robot here. Over here, yeah, that's not commercial yet. Anyway. So that's collaborative robots that we designed and built here at Aalborg University. We typically call them little helpers. This is the third generation of that, which is one of the robots I've been working on. Sometimes we make them mobile, as this one, sometimes stationary like. Most of the commercial. Okay, so let's look a little bit at robot programming. When you program a robot, you can either do it offline, like in these figures, and when you do it offline, you have simulation environments, like you have here. So you simulate the robot, and you simulate all objects that the robot needs to interact with. And that makes it possible to set up the task without actually interrupting ongoing production where the robot is in use. That's nice in some situations. In other situations, you can do it online, and that works like this. So you go out to the robot, you have some kind of a T-sprinted usually, and there are some buttons on this T-sprinted, and by pressing these buttons, you can make the robot move. So you press some buttons, make it move where you want it, and press save its location. So you press go to gripper, some way or the other, and then you move it to an object that needs to blast, you continue like that. So you basically solve the task and save points along the way, and then you can execute it afterwards. So for collaborative robots, you can also program them online. And this is examples of this. And an advantage of programming these online is that you typically actually don't have to press the buttons on these teach panels. Instead, you can move the robot around by hand. Well, this kinesthetic teaching. So it's easy to give commands to the robot, but you can just move it with your hand. It's very intuitive. And at the same time, it's very safe. So there are some problems with this. And to me, it's very visible in these images. I'm not sure if it is to you, but I can help you a little bit with these red boxes. So that's the teeth pendants. So all of the guys did have some kind of teeth pendants, or at least monitor. In this situation, you can see that this guy, he is trying to instruct something in this robot, so he's holding it with the hand, but he cannot use both of his hands. He has to hold this also, because otherwise you have no idea on what's going on inside the robot, what it's thinking, what its state is. So it has to hold this also, cannot focus only on this. So over here, they have kind of tried to solve it, so the chancellor, she's not holding any screen, but she's still, if you follow her line of sight, she's more or less looking at it. So she's not looking at what the robot is doing, no, she's looking at this. And this example from Rethink Robotics, a new company within collaborative robotics, it's even more clear. So this is from advertisement material for the Robert Baxter. And this gentleman here, he's trying to instruct it to do something with his hands and the indicator is down here, but still he's looking in a completely different direction. Because he has to make to see what the status of the robot is, otherwise he won't be able to instruct it. So we have these, mentioned these, a list of these two problems. So what I've been talking about now is robot to human. How can a robot know the state and intention of a robot? They have to use the cheat code. This has spawned one of the research main areas and the cases of this PhD. The other one is interfaces. So these robots are typically complicated, and even for some of these, for instance, we try to make a similar interface, but it's not hardware specific, it only works with their own stuff. So what we have tried to work with is to make a hardware independent way of programming robots. And then in this case, we specifically have been working with also integrating around efficient functionality in such a framework and still make it simple to use. So that's the main areas. So this vision in user-rated game framework, so hopefully an interface which is easy to use. And then the projection-based task-based interface. So the idea here is that instead of having the monitor, having the screen, we want to use projections to provide information where the task is going on. I go back to this first, a little bit about this. That's about robotic skills. So what is the skill and how should it help us do anything a program a robot easily? So in general, a skill is an easy to understand function which will transform the world from an initial state to a goal state. A scale can, for instance, be a big scale, and then the initial state could be there's an object at the table, and the goal state could be the robot is holding this object. And then the scale is supposed to transform from one state to the other state. And we're not the only ones. I'm not the only one who's been working with this. So I have added a little bit of related research here. So in the beginning, skills like this have been used as a means of doing planning. So if a robot needs to solve a task on its own, then it will be necessary to define these skills in a very formal way, how they transform the world state. So they can be concatenated to solve a task. This is within planning. That's not what I've been working with, because I try to empower the human to do it instead. Another thing is information sharing. So when you have well-defined function of robots, then you can maybe share information. So for instance, if one robot has learned how to grasp a particular object, then this information might be shared to another robot, which could then hopefully do the same thing, at least, and learn a bit about it. And then HRI, so HRI is for human-robot interactions. This is more related to what I've been working with. However, what is common for this system is that either the functionality of the function blocks are very low, like a probe to touch, which makes it necessary for any person who is using them for programming to have a certain level of knowledge. Not everyone will be able to do it. Or some of them are high level, but then have a really restricted functionality. You can't do very much in general. And then also, one of them has been looking specifically at how to integrate innovation functionality in a systematic way. So let's continue with how we see the scale and how we want to use it in a complete framework. So a robot is built of devices. Here we have a robot manipulator, a robot arm. We can sometimes have a robot base, a gearbox, and we can have sensors such as cameras. And all of these, they provide functionality. And we see this as the lowest level in a skill-based architecture for robot programming. So device primitives are functions that these devices provide. So for instance, open gripper. Many different grippers will have an open gripper function. And therefore, by providing the functions to the upper layers, we can separate the devices from the skills. So the skills use the functionality of the gripper and not the particular gripper. And then we have the skills. which can, for instance, be picked and navigate to location, place onto, which all of them use several of these device primitives. And then the skills can be combined to such specific tasks. And the idea is here that the skills should be easy to understand so that shop floor operators are able to use them to actually program the new task without having deep knowledge of what is going on inside the stomach of the robot down here. So the way we define a skill is that it should be object-oriented in the sense it should do something to an object or to the world. It should transform the state of the world. It should be safe, and it should be programmable through parameterization. So again, here we have from state to state, and then we have the skill. The main functionality of the skill is inside this block. We've got an execution. Then we have a precondition check, post-condition check, and they are supposed to ensure that the operation of the skill is safe. So this, for instance, is a big skill, and a precondition could be there is an object somewhere in the world which I can pick, so I can start picking it. Or it can be, there is nothing in my paper right now, because if there is, then I really have a problem picking another object, unless I have another robot arm. And the post-condition could then be, I succeeded in drafting this object. And we have continuous evaluation, which monitors that the skill is progressing as planned and is not trying to handle this typically by stopping the skill so an operator can see what's going on before the disaster happens. So the parameters which makes it possible to do something special, the parameters can, for instance, be which object to pick, which velocity to move with, and so on and so forth. So we have parameterization, and these parameters can in principle come from different places. And the way we're working, where we work with human-robot interactions, we want a human to specify them. We have two phases, one offline for specification, one online, which is then the kinesthetic teaching part. Specification is selecting the skills that is required for this task and selecting some parameters like, again, the velocity. The kinesthetic teaching is then moving it around to the locations where we want to have the robot. And let me just show you a video of the simple skill that you can come up with. So a pick skill, which is not using vision, not using anything advanced, only the kinesthetic teaching. So here, my former colleague is showing the robot where to grasp this object, and an approach location up here, then a leading location. And the robot will actually grasp the object, so we can continue teaching another skill. But we'll not see that. It will keep executing, so it moves to the approach, object, and leading location. So that's the simplest type of pick skill you can come up with. So programming on this, we designed we modularized the system so we can communicate and visit with different GUIs and external GUIs also, but this is the main GUI which we have really tried to make as simple as humanly possible. So we have the resolution is a little bit not ideal here, you can see, but the top button says program, run, and edit task, and then we have global control. And the essential buttons here are program. But let's just start with robot control. So here you have the possibility to move the robot around, change the robot, calibrate stuff on the robot, and that's also device independent. So no matter which supported robot or device attached, which would work. Then for programming, we can program tasks by concatenating skills. And in this case, we have hit, move to a place onto a surface. If you want to add more skills, you press over there and then get a box like this. And in this case, it's a pick skill where we can select an object and look up the parameters. And then we're then done with specifying the task. We press teach all, and then we get a window like this, which supports kinesthetic teaching. So here we get instruction as to what to actually do, in this case, teach the approach location, and how to give input to the robot so we can apply pressure in X, Y, and directions, and then an overview of the task. So in this case, it's not the object location, but a location next to the object somehow if you want to choose. So when you're done teaching, you can press that run and then select the task and it will execute different situation along the way and see what is going on. So that was kind of introduction to our framework and robotic skills. So let's see what I've been doing with the vision stuff. So we tried to look at, okay, what vision functionalities are relevant for a robot like this. And we have put some categories up here. So recognize object, host estimate object, quality control and error detection, detecting environment, detect human tracking, and detect occupied and free spaces. And then on the other side, we have functionalities of the robot and specifically different skills. And what you should notice about this figure is that much of this functionality is relevant for many different skills. For instance, the pose estimate object here for PIC is relevant to pose estimate an object. You need to know where it is and how it's oriented to be able to pick it in a right manner. For place, relative place onto, for instance, you want to place onto a particular other object, then you might need to locate that object first, so we could say this is a precondition for the relative place function here. So the point of this is that these vision functions should not be skills on their own. They don't transform the world. They don't really do anything. They're just required to be able to transform the world. So most of them should not be skills on their own. So instead, here we have part of the architecture of the skill-based system. We have devices here, which are decoupled through the device manager up to the skills. So the skills can use the functionalities from the devices found here. And then we proposed that these vision functions should be implemented as services, which also takes advantage of the functionality from the drivers here, but which are not skills themselves, but then provide services to the skills. So these are able to use multiple devices and then provide functionality to multiple skills. So doing this, I've developed a set of vision skills, which I will go through very quickly. So we developed a flexible kick with 3D vision skill, which detects objects on surfaces and picks them up. And it's flexible because it's easily reconfigurable by humans with instrumentation to pick up different objects in different locations. And we wrote a paper about that. Then I've implemented an adaptive model-based quality control system, which compares a model of an object with the object. Before we can do that, we of course need to find out where the object is and how it's oriented. And we use the same functionality as up here to do this. So that's an example where we use functionality across different skills. Then I've worked with calibration, robot workstation calibration. So if you have a moving robot which moves to a new station, it's necessary to find out exactly where it is in relation to the station before we start doing anything at this station. We wrote a paper about that, and actually we won a best paper award for this paper. But even though it's a relatively simple algorithm we used, it's not too complicated. We use QR code markers and 3D vision to estimate the orientation and location exactly. But we implemented it even as a skill in this skill-based framework. So it's very simple and easy to use for even non-experts in the same way and in the same system as they can use. And then we have made some smaller additional skills for quality check and object detection. You will see these in a moment on the next slide in a video put into production at Bunchbox and the factory robot. And also this kind of detection. Additionally, there are also some calibration functions which are necessary to do any additional object manipulation typically, and I'm not going to be seen with those. But let's look at the video here. This is the little paper 3, which uses the calibration to calibrate the station using this marker, then uses vision to estimate the position of these objects, picks them up, and then starts the conveyor belt. And it drives to another location where we do a complete assembly of a rotor inside this station. This is a press station, and I'm not showing you the entire assembly process. I'll just show a little bit of it. So here it picks up the ring puts it into the press, and then we use this external visual system to check that the ring is as it's supposed to be inside here, and it's not turning the wrong way. And we use this to ensure all steps throughout this assembly process are going as they are supposed to be. And that's also integrated into the screen-based system, so it's relatively easy even for people without PhD in robotics or computer vision to use this. So that's what I wanted to tell you about this area. So quickly on to the next area, which is prediction-based task-based interfaces. So let's just quickly recap. So we saw these images before, so we had the thing that people had to be aware of monitors while they were programming something in other places. So the collaborative robots are safe, it's easy to move around, but it's, we have to look at the two panels or monitors at the same time. And the idea here is that maybe we could use protections to provide the information in the space where the task is being carried out instead of on the monitor. And we're not the only ones who have worked with protection measures, of course. And also right in relation to robotics. So many groups have built up what they call smart spaces, which is spaces typically robotics laboratories where have multiple predictors and are able to predict stuff around in a complete surface or all around in a room and use this for different kinds of research. And so this mask is where they have a motor capture system so they track drones and then they use this projection to predict obstacles and do research into how drones are navigating relative to this. But this is specifically in labs, so it's different from what we're trying to do for. Then for mobile and guide robots, predicting navigation for different things, including predicting the intended path of the robot. So maybe if the robot is moving around, it can be difficult for a human to understand what its intention is, where it wants to go, and therefore get out of the way. But if it predicts the intended path, then there could be some advantages there. Also for prediction that we have been used for predicting directions and controls for humans to follow. Then a few people have also used it for instructing robots. We've only found one paper which have actually used prediction that for instructing robots specifically for industrial robots, and that was related to assisting disabled people in handling wooden pallets with an industrial robot. So a very specific task in the general. We've tried to work with it in a more general way. And I'll present three different studies. The first of them, I started working on this at Robotic when I went there to visit this laboratory. And the project is funded by PSA, which is behind the show in Detroit. And the project is about tracking these car doors. And the reason it's necessary to track these car doors is that, of course, it's in the factory where they are being produced and they are transported and they are hanging from the ceiling and then being transported in this direction. And but they're not fixed, they can move there. And at the same time, the robot needs to interact with them, so therefore it's necessary to track them. As you see here, humans also need to interact with them, needs to interact with them, and therefore it would be relevant for a human to know what the robot is intending to do at any given time. So what we thought it was a nice task for this, a nice use case for this projection mapping idea. So the challenges here are basically two main challenges. One, project information on something which is not a surface like the board here. So an object which has a shape, you want to project information on this which is looks geometrically correct on the object no matter how the object is turning. And that's one challenge. Another challenge is to track the object at the same time. So the point here is that when we track an object, we rely on how it looks. When we project information onto the object, it looks different. That's a challenge. So we have to find a way of tracking and the closest mechanism which would be robust to this. And what we did was a lot of calibration, intrinsic calibration. Camera and projector is relative calibration for the vector and the robot in the one to use that. And then for the geometrically great projections, we use OGL and the scene graph to render in 3D. And for tracking, we made a space ESEB's initialization for the tracking algorithm, which proved to significantly outperform a traditional post-creating algorithm based on local specific features. And the last day I was at Georgia Tech, some journalists came by. They managed to make to time it, so it was actually on the last day, and they made a promotion video about this project. So for a short time, I'll now stop talking and leave the word to myself in the video.
So this is a tracking and projection system, and what it's doing right now is to project the wireframe of this car door onto the car door. And it's doing this in real time, so you can see while I'm moving the car door around, it will actually track the car door and the wireframe will continue to be correctly on top of the car door. I can also rotate it a bit and it will continue to warp the projection so it looks correct and still in place on top.
The idea with this is, of course, that if the robot then wants to do something to the cardboard, it can be projected here and I do. In this case, me, it's a bit dark, but I'm standing here. I can make sure to get out of the way before the robot moves to where I happen to be standing. So when I got back to Aalborg University, we wanted to make some experiments with this to figure out if there's actually a big advantage with the human robot interaction by doing this. So we set up this experiment over here. So we have a very simple object which we will use to project information on. And then we set up a very simple task also, which is to move this around to a specific location and rotate it to specific angles. Sometimes a human will be asked to do it, sometimes the robot will do it. And then we compare three different interfaces, one of them being the instructions were projected onto the surface of this object with the projector up here. One of them, we turned off the projector and turned on the monitor here instead, which we have the same, exactly the same information on the monitor, which is located on the robot. And then we turned off both of these projector and monitor, and then gave the test participants a sheet of paper instead with instructions of the complete task. And the hypothesis then that the usability should somehow be higher with the projection interface. We measured usability as it is defined in this isospin line down here as a combination of effectiveness, efficiency, and satisfaction. In this case, effectiveness is the extent to which the users were able to complete the task with the errors that they might have made along the way. Efficiency is the time they spent on this task. And satisfaction, we measured that through a questionnaire where they had to evaluate different aspects of how satisfied they were. So, I have this short video of the setup, so that you can see we track the object up here, the blue lines, and then information is being projected in the green one here. So this means the robot will take care now. So for this is effectiveness and efficiency, we saw we have fewer errors with projection, but we have very few errors in general, so it's difficult to conclude upon, and that's related to the fact that this task was very, very simple, so it's actually difficult to do it more. For the satisfaction, that's a bit more interesting, and we measured that through the satisfaction with how easy it was to solve the task, how satisfied were they with the time they used, and how satisfied they were with the given information. And you can see for the time, there's really no difference. For the that seems to be a slight tendency. The biggest changes with the information, which is also what we hoped, of course, that we get a significant difference there. Unfortunately, we didn't have many test measures, only 14, so we cannot conclude that this is statistically significant, but we can see that it is a trend that there seems to be something there, at least something worth investigating some more. And if we want to investigate it some more, we could listen to some of the comments that the users made. For instance, they only had information of the three tasks that they were asked to do, not an overview of the task. So how long were they in the process? They would really like that. And also they would like to know exactly what the robot is doing, not only that it will interact with this robot. So maybe we could get some better results by getting some more information. So maybe really submitted a paper that they published. So that was study number one. Study number two, task-based HRI, human robot interaction for struggling robots. So that was the next project 5 years ago, which was a very concrete task related to manufacturing large container ships. When you manufacture a large container ship like this, you would actually have to weld studs, up to several million studs inside the ship to go into insulation, cages, and other stuff as well. And that's all done manually today. The project was about trying to automate this, or at least trying to automate part of this task with a mobile robot like this one over here. And our task here at Aalborg is I was working on as a human robot interaction for this robot. So we tried to use dictionary. So the idea was to mount a detector on the image vector and then predict what the robot intended to do on the wall actually. And the most important information was of course the stud location where it intended to red stud. That's the red dot scale. And we have some other information also such as cages, where there should be cages, where there should be fire extinguisher, that could be the other things also. And that's relevant to both to make sure that it's correct, but also to make sure that we're not building stuff where that should later be placed the fire extinguisher. So yeah, that was the idea. And then if it's not correct, of course the user should be able to change it. And we used a Wii remote and new device. So basically we used the accelerometer on this one to control a cursor, which could then change the stuff locations here. Yeah, here it looks as though the cursor comes from this remote, which is also how it's supposed to feed for the user, but of course it is actually being projected from the projector. Yeah. And I want to show you a short video of our laboratory with some of my colleagues here, who is showing how it works on the digital screen robots. And here you can see it's controlling the cursor, and it's placing, in this case, two study cases. I hope you can see it. It's dim, but it's moving on a little arms here. And then when you're satisfied, you can ask the robot to continue. And the final robot in the project, there was a feeding mechanism for these stuffs. We didn't have this here, all of the other users just done manually instead. Now the robot will use the depth camera up here to align perpendicular to the wall and then apply a lot of pressure before actually welding. So that's how this looks. And then of course you also wanted to investigate, okay, is this a good interface? Are non-experts really actually able to use this? And we made a user study with 17 persons where we asked them to complete two assignments. Number one, to validate and rectify stud distribution. So in this stud distribution, there are some errors. There are studs where there shouldn't be studs and some too close, and then some cases where there are supposed to be studs. And they were asked to correct this. So they were told how it should look, and then they should make it look like this over here where they are updated. Then assignment number two, the test instructor indicated where the test participant should weld a stud, so instruct the robot to weld a stud, and then they should instruct it and actually complete the stud welding process. And then we have the results. So we have the time here used to complete each of the tasks, and what we see is that all test participants actually managed to complete each of these tasks in less than 2 minutes. So we thought, okay, that's pretty good for the first time we tried to do this. And then for the precision, the relative position of the wheel is thus, the wheel plus minus 1 centimeter. It's difficult to say exactly what is required in this environment, but at least within a couple of centimeters, that's publicized. It's usually done now when it starts measuring. So this is sufficient for automating the task. That was the user study. Then we also integrated the system on the actual robot, and this is me testing it out in a shipyard where I started to wet some stuff in a shipyard in Spain, and it's actually in Belgium. And we bring two papers about this, published one, and submitted another one. Okay, then the last user study I want to tell you about. Device-based programming. So the idea here is that we want to take the two research directions that I've told you about. So one, skill-based programming with integrated vision capabilities, and the other is task-based predictions for user interaction, and combine it, see if we could really gain something here. So this is a screenshot of part of the skill-based system GUI. We have an instruction, some favoring graphics there, and then we wanted to take this and predict it into task-based, as you see over here. So it's the same information, it's just not on the monitor, but in the real world. And I have a video of this. And this is a video demonstrating the setup that we used for a user study, where users were asked to instruct three tasks in recognition and pick this skill, one task to do three skills. So this is me instructing a task, and you see that the instructions follow the end effector. They are based on services that the robot knows as close to the end effector as possible. And this is the first game where we want to be able to recognize objects. So basically what you do here is to take a number of images, and for each image it takes significant features, in this case 6 features. And we do that for all objects that we want to be able to distinguish between, and then we use a back and forth approach to actually figure out what object is in the image. So this was the first object, and in this case I only used 2 objects. So one of the robot to be able to distinguish between. So we also kept that series of images with second object. And the purpose of this is of course that when the robot is running production afterwards, it will be able to make sure that it's the correct object that it is trying to pick up. And another wrong one before it starts doing so. Okay, so this now has actually trained a classifier to distinguish between these objects. And now we want to teach a big skill. So we use the 3D camera up here to do that. So this is a view from the 3D camera which we use to detect the object. On the surface here. And this is then marked. So the system will mark all objects that it has found on plane surfaces. And the white one means that, and also the one with the arrow means that that's the one I'm intending to pick up. So now the operator is teaching the system how to draft this object. It doesn't have a draft. I cannot figure it out. We're taking advantage of the human knowledge to do this. And at the same time, projecting instructions and making sure they're not directly below the effector when it's so close to the surface, and also not on top of known objects. So this was the fixed skill. This is a place onto the surface in which the search for contact when facing the object. Yeah, and I'll the position and then this was the end of the instruction, and then briefly I show you how it looks when you execute this. So first it will capture a few images of this and try to classify this immediately each image and see which object it is. Here it tells to recognize it as Nescafe and Nescafe again. Luckily, Nescafe again, and therefore the robot is now sure and we continue estimating its exact location and speeding it up. And here we have another run with the same short task, so it works measurements to place on the surface. So this is how it looks. So for the results, yeah, for effectiveness and efficiency, again, we had a slightly better result for prediction, but not statistically significant. What is more interesting is, again, the satisfaction with the system. So here we have the better one is in the top, and the worst one is in the bottom. And we see for most of the sectors, each time information, they were more satisfied with the data, but it's really not big differences. And that's when we ask them to evaluate each of the interfaces individually. When we ask the test participants to compare them directly, so here we have the monitor, I like the monitor, or I like the detector more, for specific information. Then most of the test participants really prefer the detector. For instance, here, if they prefer position of information near the interfacer, with the detector, or on the monitor. And here we've got significant results. We also got some feedback, so for instance, sometimes the robot arm is blocking projection, which is obviously something that could be fixed. So, this was the end of the user studies, and then I just want to conclude my presentation here. So, we have two main objectives: investigate how to integrate and break the vision. And then I developed a set of reprogram on the skills which use computer vision. For the second objective, I've used projection learning, but the action is developed with robots in task space. And the validity of this approach is supported by three user studies. All of these indicate that this is a way that could be relevant to code. And then a bit of remarks for future research in these areas. So collaborative robots in general are definitely. The skill concept in my view is mature enough for industrialization. However, proprietary standards are in many cases slowing down progress. Integrated systems have been introduced by companies like Robotic and Robotic, which are relatively user friendly, but they only work for this specific hardware. It's really difficult if you want to integrate something else. Maybe Rust is short for robotic operating system, might help in the future. More and more robotic manufacturers are supporting this, and it makes it easier to make something which is derived from the use. Then for the task-based interaction with prediction learning, we definitely see that it has potential. So what would be interesting to look more into is which information should be predicted, which is essential, which is explainable. That's something that we did consider, but we focus more on the technology, so that would definitely be worth considering. Then it would be interesting, here we only predicted our known objects and known environments. It would be very interesting also to predict our unknown objects and particularly unknown environments. So when the robot is next to something, can we find surfaces there to predict something? And the last thing, so this is all for human robot interaction, so of course it would be nice to take into account where a human is located and where he's looking when deciding where and what to predict. And even the actions of the human might be relevant. So if he's picking up an object, maybe we should predict on this object or maybe next to it. Practice like that would be considered. That was actually the end of this presentation. And then I just want to say thank you to the three European projects, Tapas, Carlos, and Acap, which has helped fund my PhD. And this is a list of papers which I have co-authored during the PhD. And then thank you very much, everyone of you, for your attention and for being here today.
Thank you, Rasmus. Thank you. Very well done and very good introduction, I would say, but I will leave the assessment to the committee. First of all, I have to excuse. I didn't say welcome to two important persons. course, your supervisors, the co-supervisor, Thomas and Rasmus, and of course, your main supervisor, welcome to you anyway. We now have a short break, I would say 10 minutes past 9, we will start again. So if you will be part of the Q&A, you will come back latest 10 minutes past 9. Thank you.